The next item of business is consideration of business motion 12668 in the name of George Adam on behalf of the Parliamentary Bureau on changes to the business programme. Any member who wishes to speak against the motion should press their request to speak button now, and I call on George Adam to move the motion.
Thank you, Presiding Officer, and moved.
Thank you, Minister. No member has asked to speak against the motion. Therefore, the question is that motion 12668 be agreed. Are we all agreed? The motion is therefore agreed. The next item of business is topical questions, and at question number one, I call Audrey Nicholl.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. To ask the Scottish Government, in light of the Parliamentary and Health Service Ombudsman report on how women born in the 1950s were affected by increases to the state pension age, and given that women are more likely to live in poverty than men, what assessment has it made of the potential impact that changes to the state pension age have had on the poverty rate amongst women in Scotland?
Cabinet Secretary Shirley-Ann Somerville.
The Scottish Government welcomes the findings of the report which recognise the communication failures by the Scottish Government. The Scottish Government has always and will always support the WASPI women, and it is a significant moment for all those that have been involved in that campaign. We know that too many single female pensioners in particular are living in relative poverty after housing costs, 23% compared to 16% of single men in 2020-23, for example. The UK Government must take responsibility for the harm they have caused to the WASPI women by their maladministration.
Audrey Nicholl.
I thank the Cabinet Secretary for her response. Given the substantial impact that this has had on so many women, does the Cabinet Secretary agree with the Parliamentary and Health Service Ombudsman's recommendation that the UK Government, whether Conservative or Labour, should apologise for their failure to the WASPI women affected by the increase in the state pension age, and set up a compensation scheme, and that the DWP should, and I quote, do the right thing?
Cabinet Secretary.
Well, the Ombudsman report was clear that the DWP must indeed do the right thing right away. This means the UK Government must not only apologise for the harms caused by the maladministration, but they must also act. They must set up a compensation scheme that provides full and genuine compensation for the women concerned. It is deeply disappointing that after years of promises by Labour and Tory members, they are both now refusing to accept the recommendations of the report to fully compensate the women impacted. I know Alan Brown MP has a cross-party support to compensate women in a bill. Once again, it's clear that only with strong voices from the SNP at Westminster can Westminster governments be held to account, regardless of whether they be Labour or Tory.
Audrey Nicholl.
It is indeed incredibly disappointing that since the publication of the Ombudsman's report last week, the Labour Party has repeatedly failed to give a guarantee that their party in power would honour Westminster's responsibility to provide justice and full compensation to the estimated 3.6 WASPI women. Can the Cabinet Secretary provide assurances that the Scottish Government will urge the next UK Government to deliver justice?
Cabinet Secretary.
Well, the Scottish Government, as I said in my original answer, has and always will support the WASPI women. We are exceptionally concerned about the impact that inaction will have on poverty levels within Scotland. And that's why it's very important that this Parliament continues to speak about this, but importantly also to press for action. And I do note that Jackie Bailey, for example, was pictured campaigning with WASPI activists just a fortnight ago. Anna Sarwar was joined in Paisley last year, walking behind a WASPI banner. The list of every newsletter, every campaign leaflet. I'm quite happy for Mr Kerr to press a button, Presiding Officer, and ask a question, but in the meantime, I will continue to deal with the member. She is quite right to point to the betrayal that has happened to WASPI women. She is quite right to point to the fact that they don't just deserve our respect, they deserve action. And what is very clear is that there will be no change in Westminster at this rate, and that is exceptionally disappointing and the betrayal of every single WASPI woman that we have spoken about in this chamber over many a year.
Paul O'Kane.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. This is a very serious report, and I would like to thank all the women affected who have contributed to it and have campaigned over many years. Now that the report has been published, would the Cabinet Secretary take the opportunity to outline what steps she's taking to discuss the implications of this report for WASPI women in Scotland with the relevant UK ministers right now? Because I'm sure she agrees that a swift response from this UK government is extremely important in terms of the next steps, whilst listening to all of the views of all of those impacted. And given that poverty and inequality statistics published last week, which I think she referred to, show static and rising poverty rates amongst pensioners over the past decade, what more will the Scottish Government do within its powers to support pensioners?
Cabinet Secretary.
Well, I discussed this matter only yesterday, Presiding Officer, when I was at Westminster and met with my colleague Stephen Flynn, who is of course continuing to press both the UK Government and of course any successive UK Government on what they would do. And disappointingly enough, Presiding Officer, he has had no response. Be assured that this Scottish Government and also the SNP group at Westminster will continue to press for action, because I'm afraid this is where, and I have a great deal of respect for Mr O'Kane, and there are many issues where we share common cause, but this Parliament cannot just be about mitigating the worst excesses of Westminster, whether they be Labour or whether they be Tory. This Parliament is for much more than that, and I am deeply disappointed that a Labour representative comes and asks what the Scottish Government's going to do to actually mitigate against a prospective Labour government.
Alex Cole-Hamilton.
Thank you very much, Presiding Officer. I'm sure members across the Chamber will agree that time really matters in this, given that it's almost 30 years since the original seeds of this scandal were first sown, that it's more than 10 years since its impact was first realised and first came to light. And as a result, that many of the WASPI women have sadly now passed away waiting for this justice. The Ombudsman's verdict, the Ombudsman's decision will become seen as a staging post, I hope, to the final justice this woman will receive. But does the Cabinet Secretary agree with me that we can't wait or delay the implementation of the recommendations or the extension of compensation to the women that are left so that they can enjoy it in the time that remains to them?
Cabinet Secretary.
Well, the member is quite right to point out that time is indeed of the essence, and that's why I continue to call on the current government to take action. This has been a long discussed betrayal, and it is a betrayal of WASPI women. The report that has came out has laid bare the extent of that. Now, quite frankly, change should have happened already, and I think on that the member and I would agree. But if this could be the stepping stone to something actually happening and genuine compensation being put in place, then of course this report will have done its job and so much more. Disappointingly, however, Presiding Officer, it does not seem to be the case that that will actually happen.
Maggie Chapman.
Thank you. I'd also like to put on record my thanks to all the WASPI women who have campaigned on this issue for so long. Not only should their call for proper compensation be answered, because we know that some women have lost up to 6 years of their pension, we also need to continue to stand with them and join their calls for fair and fast compensation. In addition to what she's already said, can the Cabinet Secretary outline how else we can continue to support the WASPI women in their campaign for justice?
Cabinet Secretary.
Well, of course, the ability for this Parliament, this Government, to take action on this is restricted by our legislative competence around areas on reserved issues. But we will continue to use our voice within this Government to ensure that we speak up for WASPI women. And I'm sure that Maggie Chapman and fellow colleagues in the Scottish Greens will do likewise. It is disappointing, Presiding Officer, that we will not, I fear, be able to speak with one united voice to call on the current UK government to take that fair and fast action that Maggie Chapman discussed in terms of compensation.
Question number two, Ros McCall.
Thank you. To ask the Scottish Government what its response is to reports that Scotland has become the worst country in Europe for unqualified beauticians injecting customers with cosmetic treatments.
Minister Jenny Minto.
Thank you. The safety of non-surgical cosmetic procedures is a concern, and we are right now actively considering how best to take forward any future legislation. Public consultation has shown overwhelming support for tighter regulation in this area, and that is what we're working towards with key stakeholders, including healthcare professionals, hair and beauty industry representatives and environmental health officers. Indeed, my officials took part in a meeting just yesterday. This is a fast-changing sector, and any future legislation has to be robust and future-proofed. Ultimately, we want to ensure all non-surgical cosmetic procedures in Scotland are delivered from hygienic premises by appropriately trained practitioners, applying recognised standards and using regulated products.
Ros McCall.
Thank you. I thank the Minister for the response. Tens of thousands of people across Scotland now get dermal filler treatment. As its popularity increases, so do complications such as inflection, blocked arteries, blindness and even stroke. This increased popularity has been mirrored by a surge in unlicensed, counterfeit, unsafe products being passed off as Botox treatment. In 2021, it became illegal in England for a person under the age of 18 to have fillers or Botox. Stakeholders such as Ashton Collins from Safe Face, the UK government approved register for aesthetic treatment, said that she had assumed Scotland would follow. We keep asking for an update, but so far there's no agenda for them to do that. And she went on to say that the lack of action in Scotland has resulted from young people from the north of England travelling to Scotland because they can get treatments under the age of 18 with no questions asked. My question to the Minister is simple. Will the Scottish Government accept it's their lack of action is putting children at risk?
Minister.
I thank Ros McCall for that question, and I want to make clear that my focus is in making Scotland as safe as it can be when it comes to dermal fillers. We need to get it right. As I referenced earlier, it is a fast-moving area, and I'm pleased that I do have the engagement of this the expert group. I'm very happy if Ros McCall could provide any additional information or evidence that she is aware of around the processes that we're all invested in to make sure we get this as right as possible. I'm pleased that Ros McCall and myself have this as a shared issue. And I say any evidence of concerns, then please, if she could share it with me so I can share with my officials.
Ros McCall.
I thank the Minister for the response, and I'm happy to share everything that I have with her. But as the consultation was called in 2022, I'm not seeing enough urgency from the Scottish Government really on this issue. Frances Turner Trail, a prescribing nurse and director of a registered clinic, is concerned that the lack of action from the Scottish Government will actually see patients die. She said, "It's been 10 years that myself and colleagues have been sat around the table with the Scottish Government and very little has been done. And it's inexcusable because the public is now injecting the public without any redress. It's simply wrong that it's currently completely legal for a plumber or a hairdresser to inject a 16-year-old girl in the back of a van with no recourse," another healthcare professional has stated. So can the Minister confirm to the Chamber today any timescales for potential legislation, because clearly the current situation is not acceptable?
Minister.
I thank Ros McCall for her question. At this time, I cannot provide a timeline, but I am working incredibly hard with my officials to ensure that we do get this into the parliamentary legislative process. I do think it's an important area that we need to find the right legislation at the right time with the right procedures and regulations within it.
Stuart McMillan.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. The Minister is very much aware of my concerns about this issue, and I pay tribute to Jill Best Aesthetics and my constituency for their leadership in campaigning about this matter. But I'm aware of the strength of many of my constituents' concerns about this issue. And can the Minister say any more about what consideration the Scottish Government has given to regulating, and would she agree to meet with me to discuss this matter in more detail?
Minister.
I thank Stuart McMillan for his question. As I've just advised out to the Chamber, we are giving very active consideration to further legislation in this area right now, and we are meeting regularly with the expert group. This covers appropriate level of training and qualifications that might be put in place. I think it's critical, as I've said before, to get the details right, and I'm grateful to our stakeholder partners. And of course, I would be very happy to meet with the Member and Ros McCall at some point.
Stephen Kerr.
Thank you. Not doubting the sincerity of the Minister, and recognising also that she's relatively new in post, Given the answer she's given today, I'm sure she's not comfortable giving the answer she's given, because it would appear that for 10 years nothing has happened. Other parts of the United Kingdom have moved ahead 3 years ago. To understand why we're not making progress is important. So would the Minister please explain to the Chamber why it is taking so long? What is stopping us making faster progress in this area?
Minister.
I have laid out in my previous answers that we have been working very hard with experts in the field to ensure we get this legislation correct. And that is what I'm focusing on, to ensure that we get the right legislation in place and that we are supporting people that are wrongly getting injected with fillers that they shouldn't be. And perhaps we all have a responsibility in this, Mr. Kerr, and I suggest that you take time to perhaps spread the word that people should be really careful about where they go. I am suggesting that as representatives of the people of Scotland that we have a responsibility in that, and I am suggesting that you put it out in your... I am well
Mr.
aware
Kerr.
I am the government. And
Mr. Kerr, I would be grateful when the Minister is responding if you were to resist the temptation to contribute from your seat. Thank you, Minister. Are you content that your response is
I'm content.
Concluded? Thank you. We'll move on to question number three, and I call Katie Clark.
To ask the Scottish Government whether it will provide an update on what action it has taken to tackle child poverty.
Cabinet Secretary.
The Scottish Government continues to do all it can within its powers to tackle child poverty. It will continue to invest around £3 billion next financial year as part of the Scottish Government's mission to tackle poverty and protect people from harm. In 2024-25, we committed £457 million for our Scottish Child Payment, over £370 million to support concessionary bus travel for over 2 million people, and are continuing to invest around £1 billion per year in high-quality early learning and childcare. We recognise that child poverty levels remain too high in Scotland. That is, despite Scottish Government action making a difference, with our policies estimated to keep 100,000 children out of relative poverty in the coming year. Our efforts continue to be hampered by the UK Government's decade of austerity.
Katie Clark.
Data from the Department for Work and Pensions Resources Survey shows that children are more likely to be in poverty than pensioners or working age adults after housing costs. What work is the Scottish Government doing to evaluate the effectiveness of the Scottish Child Payment?
Cabinet Secretary.
Well, the Scottish Government takes very seriously our requirements to not only act, but also to research the evidence base behind what the policies are doing right across Scotland. And that's exactly why I could commend to the member, for example, a recent report by Professor Linda Bald, which looked at Social Security and the impact that Social Security is having already, despite the system being still relatively new. And I give that as one example of what we're doing to analyse the impact and effectiveness of policies, as well as talking about the actions that we will continue to take next year.
Katie Clark.
Figures released by the Scottish Government also show that child poverty levels have not reduced, despite the Scottish Government seeing it as a top priority. What other work is the Scottish Government doing to ensure that support is targeted at the poorest children?
Cabinet Secretary.
Well, as I mentioned in my original answer, Presiding Officer, we are, as a government, investing £3 billion in our work to tackle poverty and protect people from harm. Some of that is a universal offering, which I think is an important concept, which I hope members on the Labour benches will agree is an important aspect of our public services. And there are other areas which are targeted, the Scottish Child Payment being one example of that. And I think a combination of those universal and targeted approaches is the right one. I would say, however, Presiding Officer, it is made more difficult by the fact that the UK Government welfare system pushes people into poverty, and indeed we have a system where the individuals who are on benefits cannot even begin to afford the essentials of life. And that's exactly why the Scottish Government has called on the current UK Government to implement an essentials guarantee. They have so far refused to do so. And actually, it's even more disappointing that UK Labour have also refused to take that action.
Claire Hawhey.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. It wasn't so long ago that Scottish Labour were campaigning for an additional £5 payment for children, but this SNP government instead introduced the game-changing Scottish child payment of £25 per week per eligible child. Can the Cabinet Secretary tell Parliament how many children this has lifted out of poverty and confirm that, unlike the Labour Party, this government will not renege on its policy of opposition to the two-child benefit cap?
Cabinet Secretary.
Well, Presiding Officer, I notice while we're trying to have a serious discussion here on child poverty, I have Mr O'Kane and Mr Kerr on either side chuntering from a sedentary position. I am not going to get put off by having a discussion.
Sorry,
on...
point of order, Stephen Kerr.
The Minister is making a really good point, and one of the reasons why we might be saying that is the questions that she's getting this afternoon are about policies of the Labour Party or the Conservative Party. The Minister has come to explain and to account for the policies of this SNP Green government. That's why there might be some chuntering. I raise that as a point of order because I'm sure the public, as well as you, might want to know why we're exercised.
I think it's the case, regardless of members' views on contributions that other members might be making, that they always adhere to the requirement to treat one another with courtesy and respect. And I would ask that we continue our business today in that regard. Cabinet Secretary.
Thank you, Presiding Officer, and I will continue to follow your lead on the questions you choose within Parliament and answer them accordingly. That is why it is disappointing when we're having a discussion on child poverty that we should be recognising the fact that, for example, the Scottish child payment is estimated to keep around 60,000 children out of relative poverty next year. That is important forecasting work. But we know, as I said in my original answer to the Labour member for Mr Kerr's benefit, that there is more to be done. And I give one example of how much more could be done. If the UK government were to abolish the two-child limit, this could lift 10,000 children out of poverty overnight. And it's deeply disappointing that neither of the main parties in Westminster have agreed to do that. That pushes people into poverty just at exactly the time we are trying to raise them out of it.
Kenneth Gibson.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. Can the Minister advise what impact there would be on child poverty in Scotland if the Scottish Government had cut taxes by £561 million, as called for by Labour in the Scottish Budget? And has there been any indication that a future UK Labour Government, if elected, would replicate the Scottish child payment of £26.70 per child per week from April?
If the Cabinet Secretary, when responding, could focus on the matters for which the Scottish Government has general
responsibility. I'd be delighted to do so, Presiding Officer, by talking about the progressive income tax decisions taken by this Government, and that is providing vital revenue to invest in public services. And that's why it was deeply concerning that the Labour Party, as part of the Scottish Government's budget process, it chose... And it was a choice to put forward a policy that would have taken £561 million out of that. I give Mr Gibson some examples of what the government would not have been able to do. So, for example, we wouldn't have been able to potentially invest £457 million in the Scottish child payment or over £133 million to mitigate the worst excesses of Westminster welfare regime. And I think, Presiding Officer, it is telling that there is a level of discomfort as we tackle child poverty in Scotland from both the Labour and Conservative. And I think that discomfort is due to the inaction of both their parties at Westminster.
That concludes topical questions. The next point of order, Stuart McMillan.
Presiding Officer, thank you very much for taking the point of order. Presiding, can you provide some assistance regarding the implementation of the urgent question process, please? Urgent questions need to be submitted before 10 a.m. Today, news broke regarding Ferguson Benin around 11 a.m, and every MSP in this chamber recognises the importance and the significance of the yard and also the reporting about the yard for quite some time. I applied for an urgent question, and this obviously was refused because it was after 10 a.m. But what consideration will you, Presiding Officer, give to changing the deadline for urgent questions, which actually are urgent, as this is the case with today's example? Parliament's rules now leave me with no option but to wait until tomorrow to ask a question on behalf of my constituents on this vital business in my constituency.
I thank Mr McMillan for his point of order. It is, of course, the case that standing orders require the timetable that currently exists. Such timetables, of course, are open to review constantly. There's, you know, processes within the Standards, Procedures and Public Appointments Committee, which mean that any member can put forward a proposal, the committee will discuss it, and that is one way of making a change, such as that the member wishes to see in this instance. I think alternatively, the member could call for the particular order to be temporarily suspended, for example. Point of order, Stuart McMillan.
So thank you, President Officer. So with that, can I ask you, with regards to the removal of or the temporary suspension of that particular standing order, could that happen then for this afternoon, please?
In that case, Mr McMillan, I would require to have a motion without notice that standing order is temporarily suspended. Is that the motion that you wish to move?
Yes. Yes, President Officer.
In that case, I put to the Parliament that the standing order we will have to suspend business for 5 minutes, and I call for that suspension just now, Mr McMillan, colleagues.